Attorney Strang, Code Enforcement.
Before we get started, would everybody stand and raise their hand indicating that they were going to testify in these proceedings? If we're doing all one standing, we'll be not arguing this one. Except the attorneys.
So then, when they come to stand in each case, I'm going to need you to announce who's present and have them state their names.
Raise your right hand, please. Do you solemnly affirm under penalty of perjury that the testimony that you shall give in the matter now pending before the board shall be the whole truth and nothing but the truth? Thank you. So the matter before your board today, Mrs. Marquez, is so. This is a cost accounting hearing. This is not a hearing to appeal whether or not a public nuisance ever existed. That determination has been made. There was no appeal to that determination, and therefore it stands. You'll be limited today in your decisions as to whether or not the enforcement costs and penalties as reflected in attachment A or accurate and reasonable, and whether those costs and penalties should be in a special property tax assessment at a lien recorded. Please accept the written staff report as a portion of my testimony. I have a PowerPoint prepared for you today to supplement that. I'm going to go through these factors that in each and every one of these cases today, I would ask that your board consider danger to public health, safety, and welfare, culpability of the individuals involved, the willfulness of the violation, the effect of the violation on surrounding properties, the reasonableness of the corrective action, recidivism, if any, the credibility of the testimony. So the relevant facts and case regarding this case, 3362 Warehouse Road. On October 6, 2015, which was a Tuesday, staff that performed an inspection and discovered 30 marijuana plants. A notice in order to abate a nuisance was posted on the property immediately, and an administrative penalty of $3,300 was imposed. The next day, October 7th, Wednesday, a duplicate copy of that notice in order with a billing invoice stated that the administrative penalty continues to accrue at $3,300 per day. It was mailed to the property owner, HR and Branches LLC, and to the cultivators, Sandra and Early Sharp and John Dickman Jr. That same day, October 7th, re-inspection of the property showed that the marijuana had been removed and the property was in compliance with regarding marijuana. October 16th, 2015, the last day to receive an appeal, no appeal was received. So, how we arrived at the $3,300, there's a worksheet we use. 30, that's 3,000. We cited for outdoor cultivation more than 12 plants, lack of registration, so $3,300. This is what we observed during our inspection. Some marijuana there, grow bags. It's mature. And the accounting before your board today, we're asking that you look at. So with this, taking into account that recent ruling of the Superior Court, I would actually like to modify my recommendation to you today. I would recommend that your board reduce our accounting by $3,300, and if you remember, that represents the one day of administrative penalty that was imposed. Because the cultivators, Mr. Pittman and the Sharps, immediately took action to remove the marijuana, their response was consistent with the order. And if your board agrees with this, our accounting would become $4,971.28. Again, I'll bring up these factors for you. Whoops. And with that, I'm going to turn back to you for any questions you may have.
Mr. Chair, Jeremy, is this the first time marijuana patients have been done at this time?
I did not prepare for do not see any. So I can't, you know, there's been no code enforcement action.
Mr. Marquez, you have any questions?
Sure, just very briefly. Mr. Strang, according to your summary just now, you had someone from the department go out to this premises on October 6th and they noted what they believed to be marijuana planted in contravention of the Yuba County Code, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And then the next thing you did was post at the property notice to abate, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And then the next day, your department went back out there and found that the abatement hadn't in fact occurred and marijuana had been removed, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And on that same date, you sent to HR and ranches notice to abatement, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And understanding that was sent by U.S. mail, correct?
Correct.
Understanding that notice would not be received for at least a day, 2 days, 3 days later by HR and ranches, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. So it's fair to say that HR and ranches, even if they received that notice in due course, could not have abated that nuisance, let's say within 3 days of October 6th, correct?
Correct.
Okay, all right. Now, the Yuba County Code provides under 7.40.54b that a notice in order to abate shall, one, describe the condition and why the premises constitutes a public nuisance. Would you agree with that? I don't know if you want time to look at that section.
I would agree.
Okay. And then it provides that within a reasonable time, okay, and that is described normally as 3 days from the date the notice is mailed or posted, abatement should occur within those 3 days, correct?
3 days or less. That's correct.
Okay, 3 days or less. And in this case, clearly, the facts are that within 3 days or less, the abatement process had occurred, correct?
That's correct.
All right. Now, following up somewhat on the question to Supervisor Vasquez, I think you indicated that there had never been, as far as the record shows, an abatement request, let's say, or abatement process that had been instituted by the county against this property, correct?
Not in this file that I have for present.
Now, is it true, also you have no information provided to this board, that HRM ranches had ever been the subject of an abatement process, correct?
Correct.
Okay, all right. And you described cultivators, I think, as Mr. Pittman and who else?
The Sharps.
The Sharps, okay. And you believe that the Sharps and Mr. Pittman were the cultivators of the marijuana found on October 6th, correct?
Based on the staff's report that I've read, yes, I believe that they are the parties.
And isn't it true that HRM Ranches has had no responsibility, and let's start with planting that marijuana as far as you determined, correct?
Correct.
And HRM Ranches had no responsibility in cultivating or growing that marijuana, correct, as far as you know?
As far as I know.
Okay. And as far as you know, HRM Ranches had no financial interest in the marijuana located October 6th, correct?
Yes, I don't know.
Pardon?
I don't know.
Right, but no, you have no sense.
I have no knowledge.
Okay, very good. Now, in the cost of counting, there's fees and penalties that are proposed to be assessed, correct?
That's correct.
And those fees and penalties are not related to the cost of abatement, correct?
No, they're enforcement costs that are directly related to the abatement.
Okay, let me break that question down. For one, you've already stated that the cultivator removed the property, correct? Removed the quote nuisance, correct?
Correct.
Okay. The county expended no resources in abating the marijuana that was planted, correct?
No, the county did expend resources by performing an inspection, issuing a notice of order to abate, follow-up inspections, phone calls, etc.
Okay, so they instituted action to notify the cultivators to abate the marijuana, correct?
Correct.
Okay, but in the actual physical abatement, the county did not expend resources, correct?
The county didn't remove the plants, correct?
Right, that's what I'm saying. The county did not remove the plants, correct?
Correct.
And then you have, again, you have in your cost accounting money that you want, that you're charging for inspection, correct?
Correct.
Posting, correct?
Correct.
Mailing of the notice to abate, correct?
Staff time, yes.
Okay. Then on top of that, then you have administrative penalties, correct?
One day of administrative penalty that I recommended be removed.
Right. And that one day administrative penalty is in the sum of $3,300, correct?
That's correct.
Okay. And that is, as you term it, a penalty, correct?
It is.
Okay. Where in the code is it provided that penalties may be instituted or requested of a violator of this code?
Chapter 7.40.550 talks about imposing an administrative penalty based on the number of violations, and goes on to explain the process in which we apply them.
All right, very good. All right, no further questions.
Any questions from the board? To the chair.
Do you want to keep the $3,300 administrative? Yes or no?
Is that addressed to me?
Yes.
I'm sorry, what's the question?
Do you want to keep the administrative penalty? Yes or no?
We, in my representation of HR and Rand, we would submit to the board that we are not responsible legally or even morally for the abatement costs, the administrative costs, the penalties. So we're asking the board to find, as was described, the purpose of this meeting is to...
This was initiated by your action to grow marijuana.
It was not. It was not.
Well,
there was
marijuana being grown.
That's correct. And this is not a strict liability issue. It is the code and the state law and the constitutional law provides that for such an ordinance to be constitutional, there has to be due process, which requires notice and ability to abate. And the code itself provides, chapter 7.36, I can't remember exactly the section right now, provides for a 30-day notice in the 7.40.540B provides for a 3-day notice. So that's the due process, and that's what makes this ordinance as written constitutional. However, in contravention of the due process which is provided in the code, there is in fact strict liability imposed against landlords, landowners, and that would make the execution of this ordinance unconstitutional in my legal opinion. And the government code also decided within the enactment provisions of this code also showed a due process requirement that, in fact, the alleged violator is supposed to be noticed to appear before the board to be explained as to the notice, I mean, to be explained as to the infraction, given the ability to have a reasonable amount of time to abate it. And then, if they cannot abate it, then the board has the authority per the government code to enforce or to abate it, and also to charge the violator with the cost of abatement. And that code does not provide for penalties, which is provided in this ordinance. And that's another issue. I don't think constitutionally that this board, through this ordinance, can apply penalties. They can apply base cost of abatements. But again, the government code, the Yuba County Code itself, provides for due process. Due process has not been afforded my client. Absolutely.
Thank you very much. I have no further questions.
Do we have a limitation? Were these plants destroyed? Or were they simply
they were just simply gone
So where they were moved to, if they were arrested?
I would defer to Officer Clark to see what she discovered when she made the inspection.
To your knowledge, when you came back, these plants were gone. Was there evidence that they were destroyed or evidence of any existence of them at that point?
There were evidence that he had taken the portions of the plants that were useful to him and he had them drying in a camp trailer, but that's not a code enforcement issue. That's a different My primary purpose is cultivation. So he had removed the plants.
Can I just have a follow-up clarification as to who he is?
I'm
the
sorry.
Pronoun without a description.
I'm sorry. He, the gentleman was Mr. Fenton.
All right. Thank you.
Through the chair, I have a question for HR and branches, or a couple of questions.
Before we go there, was there any evidence you wanted to present?
I think based upon the records we have, I think I'm comfortable. Well, actually, let me just call Mr. Pittman just to make sure that the board has any questions, Mr. Pittman. Could you state your name for the record, kind of call it for you? Mr. Pittman, back in October of 2015, did you have any connection to 3362 Warehouse Road?
Yes, sir.
Okay, could you explain before what your connection was to that premises?
I was taking care of the property and I had a small garden in back.
And at that time, were you living on the premises?
Yes, I was.
When did you start to live on the premises?
I would say February 2015.
And when you started to live on the premises and throughout the time that you were living on the premises, to whom did you believe that property belonged?
To my uncle Mike. So Mike and Mike were saying, they're not even on none of the people who I'm staying in the house from, they're not even on none of this paperwork and nothing like that.
All right, well but throughout the time period of 2015 when you were residing on this property, you believe that your uncle Mike and Ben was the property owner, correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. And he's the one that gave you permission to reside there, correct?
Yes, sir.
And he's the one that knew that you were cultivating marijuana there, correct?
He didn't know what was going on.
Or he did not know?
He didn't know, no, okay. Sir.
Have you ever had any communication with anybody related to HRM branches regarding your residence at that location?
No, sir, not at all.
Any communication regarding your cultivation of marijuana at that premises?
No, sir.
All right. Thank you.
I had no idea about HRM until this came in the mail and had HRM on there. I'm going, who is this? So I tried sending HRM letters myself because, it's not their fault. I was the cultivator myself, so I'm not going to put my problem on somebody else, but I couldn't get a hold of nobody. My uncle, but we tried sending letters, nobody could get hold of nothing, so it's like a standstill pretty much. I know what to do.
All right, very good. That's all the evidence I have.
I have a question for Mr. Pittman. Mr. Pittman, did you come to our office at some point and ask about the fees and administrative penalties that were imposed?
I called in, yes, sir. I didn't come in, I called.
You called?
Yes, sir.
And do you remember who you spoke to?
I do not remember.
Okay. Did you make an arrangement to make payment with the person who spoke to work?
They were going to work with me and dropped it to two different payments.
Okay.
They were going to let me do half and then half again.
Okay. What prevented you from coming in and making those payments?
The property itself, there's two houses on it. I only had 20 plants myself and my neighbor up front had 10. But it was all going on the same fine. You know, I was going to pay it because, like I said, no, I'll pay it. But I'm not going to pay for my neighbors up front came too, and the people up front, the front property, they don't care about the nine-offs. They're not here today. They don't give a rat's because now their name is going on the property. And I'm like myself, I'm not going to do that to the property owner because why am I going to make them responsible for something? HR, I don't know who that is. I didn't have no idea about them until this letter, until the code enforcement came in the mail, and I'm going, who's HR, you know? When my whole time, I'm going to do it with my uncle Mike.
Okay.
And it's come to find out the property's being split, and that's why I'm going to HRM.
So you recently were dealing with Uncle Mike?
Yeah, I'm still there.
Okay, all right.
Thank you. Mr. Pittman, if you wouldn't,
don't go yet.
Oh, he has an appointment, so, okay.
have some questions.
Oh, you do? Okay.
When you're renting the property, were you making payments to your
The property, the back house has been sitting, it's been a farm for the last 20 years, been a family, where it's been running down, it's getting old, can't take care of it. And he told me, look, man, he's still here, he's to take the property, build it back up. So I've been redoing the rooms and floors and carpet, and just working on the house while I'm staying there. And that's how it came about.
So in lieu of paying rent, you're making improvements to that?
Yes, sir.
And that was for your Uncle Mike?
Yes, sir.
And as far as you do, he's the one who owned the property?
Yeah, I had no idea about none of this until I took the paper to him, and he goes, well, the property's been split, but that's not supposed to happen for 20 years or something like that. So I had no idea about none of this. And Mike, he didn't know I was going. He came out and looked at the house, but he didn't bother me back 20 acres, you know.
In the time you've been there, your Uncle Mike ever come out to visit you?
Yes, he would come out frequently, come out to the house and look around, but he never went out in the back behind all the chickens and everything back there, because there's no need for him to go back there.
And that's where the marijuana was?
Yes, sir. You couldn't see it from the road, it was completely gone. No, I had no neighbors around me. As far as I knew, I was had a good garden away from nobody. No one could see it outside, out of mind. My neighbor couldn't smell it, no one could smell it, can't see it, you know. And that's pretty much how it was. It was just hidden in the back. So he never seen it either. When he came to visit, he was just in the front house, front two houses, didn't ever walk to the back.
And so when you discovered or found out about HR? Did you make any attempt to contact them?
Yes, we sent notarized letters and but they never signed them. They wouldn't accept. I couldn't, until today, it's the first time I've seen anything with them trying.
As of today, do you have any kind of rental agreement with them for the property?
No, sir.
So you're staying at a place owned by somebody? But you don't have any type of agreement with them for staying?
No, I don't. I can have a window by the end of the day. I just a friend of the family just had let me work on his house for a little bit.
Okay, but you've been there for a year and
it's almost been a year.
That's
right. Over a year.
Any other questions? I know you have to leave, so.
No, that's my baby. I got a baby. My first baby's born today.
Through the chair, I just have one more question.
Okay.
Can you tell me who Rebecca Mathan is?
Rebecca Mathan? That is Mike's wife. Uncle Mike's wife.
Okay, thank you.
And just for clarification, you were asked by Mr. Obby if you had no agreement to stay there. You had a verbal agreement.
Yeah, I had a verbal agreement.
Okay, so that was with your Uncle Mike.
Yes.
All right, very good. Thank you.
Yeah.
Just real quick, Mr. Strang, looking at this billing statement as part of the package, there's a billing statement that starts with a date of August 19, 2015 and ends in August 6, 2015. Correct?
8-19 to October 6, correct?
Okay. And I think, I just wanted to make this clear, I'm pretty sure we already got this out, but throughout that time period, while there was really no prison, isn't it true that never prior to October 6, 2015, did you ever notify HRM of any problem related to the property that is the subject of this case?
That is correct.
Okay, all right, very good. That's all I have.
I just have a couple of questions for HRM. I don't know who that is.
Yeah, I don't think we're going to.
Okay. Let the record reflect. In 2005, I show a grant deed recording from Rebecca Matheny to Yuba Cal Investments. Again, 2005, reported May 31st, 2005. In 2012, January 24th, 2012, I show a grant deed recording recorded transferring the property from Yuba Cal Investments to HRM Ranches. So from January 24th, 2012, to date, based on what Mr. Pittman said, I can only estimate that HRM Ranches has never been to this property, or that the company that owns it has never been there.
out.
And they are not here today.
They are not.
Is there an ability to proportionally look at that split between the sharps and Pittman?
If there were an administrative penalty imposed, I would suggest that yes, you absolutely could do that because you could divide that number by plants. If your board chooses to follow my recommendation of eliminating that penalty, we have fees that are just blanket fees. I don't know how we would want to split that unless we just took the total number of plants and divided it by
thirds.
Whatever, yeah. How are we going to come up with it?
To the chair, so the total amount that you're talking about is $4,971. Is that correct?
That is my recommendation, correct?
Yeah, I mean, I think this, if I'm understanding the motion,
as a matter of law, that's improper. The code requires that before someone can be charged with any kind of fees or assessment, they have to permit or allow the nuisance. There's absolutely no evidence that H.R. and Ranch has permitted or allowed this nuisance to occur. Due process to make this constitutional requires a 3-day notice before fees and costs can be assessed, unless it's a, this 3-day minimum. The government code section, which provides for due process that I cited earlier, is cited in the proposed order. That's government code section 25845. That is the due process that the state law affords. That's in addition to the due process which is provided within the code, in addition to the constitutional protection which is provided by state law. I mean, by state stare decisis case law. There is no basis that this board can legitimately impose any fees or costs against HR branches, and I'm asking the board not to take any action against HR branches. Thank you.
Chair, I would just like to state that the section, the government section that he cites, authorizes local jurisdiction, I believe, if I'm remembering correctly, the public nuisance against provisions that are before. Chapter 7.40 specifically provides for not offering or not requiring any advance notice of violation be provided. I would agree in some regard to the fact that an administrative penalty imposed without an opportunity to correct if the property owner was unable to abate the nuisance might be appropriate. I would have to think about that. But what I would say is that that section offers for the abatement of public nuisances. Our order was proper, and the enforcement costs associated with that order was proper, and it allowed for an appeal right, which was not exercised. Mr. H.R. Ranches was in possession of our order, had an opportunity, a 10-day opportunity, to appeal that order, and they chose not to, and for whatever reason. And so I would submit that they did have an opportunity to appeal, they did not exercise that right.
Mr. Marquez, I'm not clear. Are you here to represent Mr. Pittman or HRM
Ranches?
And as to HRM, my own personal view is the fact that they have not responded to any inquiries from Mr. Pittman or apparently from anyone else, as far as I am personally concerned. Their failure to do anything does not excuse them from their claim that they had no knowledge, they did not participate at all. If you want to choose to be ignorant, it's your choice, but there are consequences to that choice. And so that's my own personal view.
And I would submit respectfully that your personal view is inconsistent with the government code, the Yuba County ordinance, and again, stare decisis, constitutional law. It requires due process, it requires a notification. And there's no, the record is complete with the fact that HR and Ranches did nothing to allow this to occur. And there's no basis upon which the government generally can impose fees and costs against HR and Ranches.
To the chair, call a question. We have this motion in second.
Okay, so all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Roll call on the motion. Contrary.
Supervisor Vasquez?
Yes.
Supervisor Vasquez?
Yes.
Supervisor Abatement?
Yes.
Supervisor Fletcher?
Yes.